Greetings to Israel. Shabbat Shalom, Mishpacha Chol, Israel, greetings. Unto the Shebet, the tribes of Israel scattered, not just throughout the Olam, but the Erech, the earth, the four corners, throughout the land. As the old Kiddushim would say, beyond the seas of the ports that we are nearby. And so we greet Yisrael scattered with Shabbat Shalom, be it Yisrael, the riches of Yah, his Oshia, the great riches of his power, his truth, his wisdom, understanding rest upon you all. Wherever you have joined us from this live broadcast, I do want to say to you that are having difficulties trying to listen on the audio, you're going to have to go to the visual stream today. We're having technical difficulties here. We're having some problems with the software. So we're having those difficulties. So if you would log on or go right to the site, you're on the site, and then click on the visual, the video stream. It is much better. There's clarity in the voice you can hear. Yah grants us the financial reservoir of funds, then we will be able to upgrade. We need to do that, Israel. And there are you that have been listening for a long duration of time, but you have never strengthened the hands of the messenger nor the work of Yah here, where others can be blessed and receive the fullness of Yah's riches. I received a letter on this past week. I wanted to read it. And the person said in the letter, I listened to you for 3 years, Reach. Yet, as I listen, Yah has granted me to understand and to garner wisdom. It has been a strength and a great blessing to my life. And I do appreciate you. There was one that wrote on this past week telling me of their lifestyle and the styles of what humanity call life, and said to me, I don't know why I continue to be drawn back to this site, because the person declares unto me, quote, I am a strong woman, unquote. My reply was, because you are opinionated and you are loquacious, it doesn't imply that you are a strong woman. Because you have been around men all your life, not all men are strong. You have simply learned the ways of a man. I say, here is a strong woman, Mishuli 31. You read that. It is amazing how incomprehensible this generation is. Everybody knows everything. I don't want to know everything. I don't want to be the master of everything. Everybody knows everything. And then you have those that are the zachim, those that's supposed to be wise with wisdom. You will see their wisdom on their countenance, and you don't see that today. You will see the intellectual learnings and spiritual learnings on their countenance. You cannot tell me what something is implying when you don't even know how to define the simplistics of terms and terminology, and you talk from a elementary approach. You cannot teach me. You cannot get comprehension of Torah by reading one or two verses, Kidvei, and think that that constitutes the legitimacy of knowledge of that matter. You can't do it. I look at one verse, and then there's a compository of 100 or 200 verses that I must understand to understand the intricates of that. What I shall teach you, the Hanuch, Hanach, Enoch, there were probably 20 pages of Torah scripture. So I had to break it down to around 5 or 6 that we can comprehend the legitimacy of what the messenger of Yah is trying to imply unto us. And those that try to talk from the teaching of Hanukkah, they don't even understand the Bereshit or the Reshit. In the Reshit, in the Bereshit, Yah, He bara, He created the heavens, the Hashemaam, and the Olam. And everything else that proceeds from that gives us a detailed analogy of the process and the processes in order for His principle to be integrated into the lives of the nation of people, for one thing, that it may bring about a resounding resolution to Shecha, as we would say, to worship Him. This is a generation that is incomprehensible. It doesn't comprehend. It doesn't understand. It is a generation of no knowledge. When a man is wise, he has the beauty of the content of his wisdom that express. Can I show an example before I proceed? Proceed. When Raphael and I went out on Thursday to take care of the business of certain aspects of the community life, I made mention there was an elderly Caucasian woman with her husband. You knew it was a husband. And they was bent and crippled. He was walking with this lethargicness of his efforts. And she was not that better off. You could tell they have come to rely upon each other. And she relies upon me and I her. That she knew exactly what side to get on. He was not as coherent as she was, his surrounding. He was not. And so after I came out of the store, I was walking toward the vehicle. And so she looked at me, and there was this rosiness that her whole facial expression changed. It was not that the older woman was looking at me for some kind of ulterior, juvenile motive, but it brightened up that elderly woman's day, and she didn't know how to speak, but she spoke to me. The husband wasn't even aware that she looks at me, she looks at my eyes, and she follows me, and she looks me up and down, and she didn't know how to speak, so I said, "How are you?" And so what she saw, let me say this, the wisdom of strength, the blossoming of life, that's what wisdom does to one. You are people that's ignorant. And someone reads something out of Hanukkah and they understand. They can tell you the legitimacy of it. They know everything. It's not so. It takes a toilsome, it takes a laborious effort to understand the nuances of Torah. Before I began in Hanukkah, I want to read some verses for us. I speak to Kol Yisrael. I speak to the whole house of his nation. Where are the elderly men of beauty and strength? I want the reflection of Yahshua to shine. It's not how I dress. It's the aura and the ambience of my ruach, my spirit. And it makes no difference where you are. You say that boastfully because I can exude the identity of Yahshua in me. I know what's in me. You think you're better, I'm better than you when it comes to my submitting. For thou excelleth you. Whom you rise above them all. Very few men that Yah call great. Very few men he call Gadol and Geba. Very few men. But there are some that are set apart. And they are different. We preach about these men, and yet we don't understand that that same constitution that is much more of a tremendous power today that was in Daniel So it is in Yisrael today. We must have men that have a greater insight than Daniel yet. We're coming to the end. It takes something to come to the end and finish the race. It takes a resolve that is greater than the start of the race. Because you are expense, you have labored, you are exacerbated, you're tired. You have gone beyond the limitation you have as a marathon runner. You have blisters on your feet. Your legs are cramping. The waters are, the potassium, it's not doing its job to restore. So you must draw within a reservoir of something that is far greater than your conscience of thinking, how do I overcome this? And it's not as much as my physical dimension and the power of my physicality. It's something that is greater than that. It's something that is greater than that. It's something that is greater than that. So you draw on the laborious exercises of your tenacious pace and the tenacity of your regard for the course. And yet there is only one constitution you have in your mind, that is to accomplish, overcome, to subdue it, and it not overtake me. So we're in the end. We're in the Akarif, so it takes a man of greater stamina and beauty than Daniel, than Obadiah, than even Hanuk. He walked with Yah, and he pleased Yah. He did not see death. What death? What Muth or Mavith? That sin doesn't destroy the power of the testimony of Yeshua HaMashiach. When sin, when sin has finished its course, when it has accomplished its desire, it brings forth death. It brings forth separation. It brings forth a separation. So he did not see death. He did not see the power of sin ruling in his life, whereby he could not hear the very oratory voice of Yah as he spoke unto him. Out of the volume of one thing, the zikron, the memoria of the forefathers that he had seen. So he brought forth one out of his loin, Methuselah, that lived almost a day in the sight of Yah, 969 years. He didn't quite make a day. But he lived. And we must be like the Hanuk. In order to be like the Hanuk, we must please. Yah must have her fits. It must be his pleasure, his delight to look upon us and say that this is my beloved son, in whom I have great pleasure in him. And it began with those that guard the gate. The word gate, the posts, and those that guard it. And the elders among Yisrael, that's why they sat in the market in Yerushalayim. Because they could see, they could discern, and they knew, and they could discern the wickedness, say, go bring that boy here. And they were reproved and rebuked by the order of the Torah. But today, most old men are as foolish, but they're more foolish, more insecure than the young ones today. It is the truth, old woman. So we're the ones that guard the gate. Ask my Zachin Benjamin to put a message together for me on that. Can I say this to us? You all look at your faces. Get those crazy looks up, all right? I said to my Zachin Benjamin to prepare me a message. He will get it done. It's one thing that we must understand. I'd rather have the strength of a weak man than the strength of 10 beautiful baths of Tizayon. His strength is made perfect in all of his weaknesses. His lethargic walk, his pining away. There's nothing like a man. It's nothing like the beauty of a man. And the baptism of Zion, his issue, even the beauty of Yisrael, cause him to elevate to the strength of excellence. Without him, without her, it's the beauty of the birth of Zion that he regards as the beauty of the fragrance of Omaniyan Yoshua. Where are the men today? I'm not going to stop saying that. Can I say this in my email? People write one this morning, the comments were so negative. Call me Johnny Cash. I'm not afraid of the negativity of men. I post just what they said so others can see. I'm not afraid of their negativity. I'm not afraid of what they say against me. It doesn't affect me. It does not inflict any wounds upon us, me. So I even post the negative comments that here is this Johnny Cash, this lame. You don't even know Yah. People, the spirit, the ruach of Yah is not with that man. I love it. I have no compunction with that. But a weak man would have compunction. I want to read this and I'm going to teach on Hanukkah. It's important that I read this because the book of Hanukkah will validate the purpose of this. I want to read this as he passed these booklets out. They are not the best informed, but they are better than what we have. It has replaced the name. The Ark have done a wonderful job. We just don't have the equipment to produce a truly bond of a book. So when Yah blesses us with the funds, we will get that. And we will produce nice books, not staple, but nice books and booklets for the people to send out, that they may treasure the simple knowledge in those booklets. We have elderly men around us. They should write on the power of the Zakein, the beauty of a Zakein. Hell, the reason we can't write it, because hell, we don't exemplify the beauty of a Zakein. And the elderly daughters of Baptist, instead of them wanting to act silly as hell and immature, if they have a plethora of wisdom, they should share that with those that may not have the strength of their knowledge. If y'all granted me the time, I could write tremendously. I know how to. And it is not about the grammatics. If a man has the ruach of Yah, he can write in a way that it is profound. And even the most ignorant will understand. But because we don't have a damn thing, we don't have the knowledge of his Torah, then we can't do it. If I had the time, I could write some powerful books and booklets for Yah's nation. But I know my time is drastically depleting. And I don't want to leave this world without making sure that my ark, at least they have the seed of that, that they can progress, allow that seed to be nourished by what? The hearing, the cleansing of themselves by the hearing of Yah's Torah, and allow that to be nurtured. A fool will never allow that. Can I read this for us? I want to read this in the book of Mishli, Proverbs. We greet you all that have joined us, our friends that have joined us on the live broadcast, the audio, the visual stream. However, you're hearing us today. We're here on Yah's Shabbat. This is a Shabbaton. And we're going to rejoice in it. I'm going to be glad. Hallelujah. It says in Proverbs, it says in the book of Proverbs, in Mishli, Proverbs, it says in Proverbs, chapter 17, verse 27. Proverbs 17:27. It says this. He that has da'at, knowledge, he's a wise man. He's a man of spiritual intellectualism. He's a wise man of intellectualism. That he can talk with the philosophers. He can talk with the intelligentsia. And yet he can extrapolate from the dimensions and the dynamics of Yah to bring about a knowledgeable content of his wisdom. He can do that. So with a man that has knowledge, the Torah says he hashach, he spares, he retains, he holds back. He keep himself in check. And there are times he refrain himself from speech. Proverbs 17 and verse 27. So with a man, you will know that a man has wisdom. Or that a man that has the da'at of Yah, the knowledge of Yah. We'll find this out in Hanukkah. All right. This is a man that Hashach, he spares his words. He know what to say, when to say it, how to say it. He just doesn't speak because he hears of the turbulence of the speech of others. And it says, a man of understanding, he is, and the Torah used the words at dia. He is an excellent man. He is gallant. He is set apart from other men. He is a man of great strength and beauty. He is a man that is at dear. He is a man that his principles are so noteworthy that even strangers acknowledge that he is not a man of our coast. He is not a man that has the appearance as we. Draw on my experience. I was at the sale some weeks ago, the cattle or the small animal sale. And of course, there was this array of people in there. I knew exactly how many people were there. Can I tell you how I know? Because I'm an observer. I counted. I looked at the countenance. And of course, they watched me. Why? Because among that gathering, I had a strange identity. I was the only man of the dark hue or skin color that was there. So my look was not of the same look. And they looked at me and they watched me, and I sat in my chair eating my sunflower seeds and drinking my water. That's what I did. Were you afraid? Not at all. Were you intimidated? Not one bit. I exude my place. And I sat there with a tenacious, powerful aura. I knew who I was. And I know who I am. That's a man of excellent idea. He is of excellent strength. He is of beauty. It says his words, a man of understanding is of an excellent. He is of an idea. He is of a unique characteristic. His characteristic is sound. It's beautiful. His ruach is excellent. I am a searcher of things. To bring it down to our understanding, there's a Hebrew word that in this expression of excellent, it is just like a car, C-A-R, but it's spelled K-A-R. Ha, ha, ha. You know what it means? Can I tell you, my Zakim? It means this. He's a man that knows how to chill. That's what it means in the Hebraic dialect. He knows how to chill. And not only does he know how to chill, he's cool. Now, that's the expression of this idea. He knows how to chill. He would say, chill out. He knows how to chill. And you wonder where we got expressions in our youth. We didn't understand that, but it was the breading or the ingraining of our forefathers, these words. We did not know what they meant. We would see that comment. You would say, that's cool, baby. I don't give a damn if you don't like me. Your ignorance repel what I say. You don't know what I know. You spend too much time talking instead of listening. You want to be wise, you must learn how to shema. Wise man, he hears and he ponders. Again, this wise speech of Shlomo speaks to us in the 13th chapter of Proverbs. Proverbs Mishri, Proverbs 13:20. Now, this is profound here for us. Proverbs chapter 13 and verse 20. It says to me, he that walks, the word walks is halach. When you halach, Proverbs 13 and verse 20. He that walks, he that halach, strive in the same pattern, the same way. He that walks with a wise man, he that walks with wise men, so undoubtedly they are wise men. There are men that have their hukah, they are wise. They have the experience of Torah. The power of the testimony is of such greatness, of its passion in them, that there are men that are wise to the order of Yah. So when a man walks with a wise man, he will become wise as well. You walk with a fool, you will act like a fool. You cohabitate with immature, insecure men, you will be that way. So when a man walks with a wise man, he shall be wise. But a champion of the eschel of fools shall be destroyed. You that champion the environment of fools, how do you know the strength of a wise man? Can anyone tell me? Don't answer me. Do you know the strength of a wise man? Ponder it for a second. Can I tell you? I'm not going to, Zakir, I'm glad he puts us on the spot. Do you know the strength of a wise man? If I tell you, will you believe me? Will you believe me? Will you trust me to tell you the truth? Do you think I know? Do you think I'm that immature and that unwise that I don't know? Will you believe me, my email, if I tell you? This is the strength of a wise man. Will you believe me, mama? I know you will. Reprove a wise man and he becomes wiser. Reprove, admonish a fool, you will see it in his expression. You get yourself a blot. That's the beauty of a wise man. He receives correction. He loves correction. So that's why I say, when I got things on our YouTube channels that people live here, how the onslaught of their speech against me. I leave it up there. I'm not fearful of what these boys can do to me. I'm not afraid of their words. I'm not my path. I'm not afraid of their words. It doesn't cause trepidation to feel my heart. I feel that they said this. What do others think? Come on. What do we think of Yah? So that is the beauty of a wise man. When a man walks with one that is wise, boys, Abner doesn't like to hang with me. He like those of his age group. When I say to him, son, you come to my house, the only way I can get him there, I must give gifts. I must lure him and draw him on his passion. And that doesn't last long. He's ready to go in the moment. He doesn't want to hang around me. He wants to hang with those that are of his age group. It makes no difference. So when you find a wise man, he loves the company of wise men. Because a wise man will always correct you. Always. It is the truth. But those that are champions of foolish thoughts and fools, they shall be destroyed, eviscerated. Shamach, brought down. It's important that you hear these, or this preface to Enoch, Hanak, Hanuch. It's important. And from the voice of Shlomo again, a man that was wise, was he not? And he failed Yah, did he not? He went down to his own passions and his own lusts. He forgot Yah. It doesn't take you 10 years to forget him. You forget him, we forget him overnight. He speaks in Ecclesiastes, in Kohiti, Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 17. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 17. Because Enoch speaks for one time. And there's a reason why he said what he said concerning the time, the seasons of Yah's appointed time, that we will prepare ourselves for the coming and the advent of Yeshua HaMashiach. But he says here in Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 17, it says that the Dabarim, the words of the wise men, when men are wise, when men have the wisdom of Yah, when men have the experience with Yah to bring about discernment of understanding, the words, the speech of a wise, of the wise men, it is heard more in quietness. It is heard more in quietness when he doesn't even speak, more than the za'ach, the cry, more than the great sound, the cry of him that rules among the kesef, among stupid, ignorant, simpleton, fools of no knowledge of Yah. It is the wise man that I go back to the analogy of the lady that she was much older than me. But don't tell me through our appearances and our look and our facial expression, people don't discern. Because if that's not right, someone will say, what's wrong with you? You ever looked at someone and say, what's wrong? You know something is wrong. And when a man has wisdom here, he has knowledge of Torah, it's a reflection of the wholeness, the word soul, the word nefesh. His nefesh is the beauty of the abundance of life in his physical form. The soul is more than something hidden in the inside. The word nefesh is the complete man, the life of his mind, the life of his purpose, his will, the breath that caused that to emanate, to flow from him with great beauty. Not many wise men today. Without wise men, you don't have them guarding the shecha, the gate. The gate, the entrance into the city. The entrance into the city. It must be guarded. It has to be guarded. We are the salt of the earth. We lose the power of the testimony of Yeshua. That we're tough for nothing. Throw it out. Let it be trodden underfoot. Because we are a city. We what emanate the life of Yah. The light. Yeshua declared, I'm the light of the Olam. And we have this testimony in us. It's a brilliant light. And people may not can look in your face because you can't look at the greater power of Yah's creation, the sun, or the luminaries. You can't look at the ma'or. And so when they look upon you, they see the beauty of strength. That's what that old woman saw. She saw the beauty of strength. It refreshed her. It made her life to be refreshed. That's the truth. She saw one that was erect. He was correct. No, I know what you saw. Are you boasting as though you're something? We're so immature and so silly. Why would not we esteem the ark greater than we esteem ourselves? So the old woman in her look, her expression to me, she esteemed me. She said, I don't know who you are. You made my day just smile a little brighter today. And she did smile. She did. Several accounts that day. But that one was refreshing to me. I knew what she said. And that's what Yisraya speaks to the nations, to the Goyim, the nations, those that are disenfranchised from the commonwealth of Israel. That's why he caused one to walk with him that will not see death, my heart. The mood that one will not die prematurely to sin, to give oneself over to the pleasure of one's own flesh, sin. That's why there have been men that made themselves eunuch for Yah's sake. And there are those that Yah has called to be eunuch. I've had men to tell me they were eunuch, and all of a sudden the whole philosophy of that changed. You're either a eunuch or you deceive yourself. You either true with Yah or you're not. It's almost like me saying, I would never do that again. You bring me out of this. And when he brings you out, I do it again. Just being legit with you. There are those that say they were prophets, and then all of a sudden they're pastors. There are those that say they were pastors, and then they're elevated to apostles. This is a discombobulated world, Yisrael. Yet they don't, it is a generation that is incomprehensible to the knowledge of Yah. Simply, they cannot comprehend, they don't know, they don't understand. And that's just a fact. And you're not dealing with some little boy. And that's why Yah says to Yeske, do not be afraid of their faces. I don't give a damn about the faces of Yisrael. You sit at your homes, you sit here, you wanna look like a damn crazy man or woman. Look like it. I'm not intimidated by it. Not me. Wise money has a countenance that brings and calls the light of Torah to shine because he's wise. And his mind is pure. Unto the pure, all things are pure. Unto those that are defiled and unbelieving, there is nothing pure. You got men that can't even quote one scripture. And yet they're wise. I will hide this Torah in my lamp that I sin not. Hanuk was a man that walked with Yah. Halach, the path, the journey. What? Hand and hand? Sure, hand in hand. But of all that, the words that had permeated his mind from the hearing of the Torah. It is amazing how those men could hear as young lads and they could recall as Shemuliah when Eli, when there was a dearth of darkness in Israel. And Hanukkah says, I will give my son to the service of Yah. She didn't take him back. She didn't go back on her word. She gave him to Yah. And when Yah began to speak to that young lad, he didn't know, he didn't understand. Even with his Ema, she wasn't sure. When she went to the messenger of Yah, Eli, he says, maybe you're drunk. And then Yah calls that elder that he killed his sons, Hophni and Phinehas, and destroyed him because what he allowed through the gates. When he's knew that it was Yah, he says, son, next time, just tell him to speak. We need that Ruach today. Speak to me, Yah. Speak to me. Speak by this testimony of who I shall speak by the testimony of Hanukkah. All right? I want to give a little preface here in the book of Yeshua, Isaiah. There must be a chuchmah, a wisdom, Isaiah chapter 46. We must have a wisdom that we have drawn on from the experience that we have experienced with Yah. And so Yah gives us an instruction as Isaiah chapter 46, verse 9, Yeshaya. He tells us in verse 9, Zechar, remember, he tells us to remember the former or the first things, as we say, Yam Rishon, the first principles. He says, I want you to tie them in your heart as a zikron. Remember the former things of old. when you were young, Isaiah 46, 9, when you were young, I want you to remember the experience, how you were developed, your attitude, how you shape it. Remember the former things, for I am Almighty Yahweh, and there is none else. There is no. There is no comparison. There is none that equates with me. There is no other but me. He says, I am higher. I am Yah. I am he that has come. I've entered in. I stand. I am Almighty Yah. And then there is none with the likeness of me. There is none like me. He tells the Nabi. He says, I want you to know God. I want you to declare. I want you to inform. I want you to instruct. He says, I want you to know God, instruct, declare. He says, the acharith, the end first. You must declare the end first. From the reshith, the beginning. So you tell them of the end, and you take them back to the bereshith. In the reshith, in the beginning, Yah created. In order for us to understand Hanukkah, we got to go back to the reshith. The first word came out of his mouth, Beth. You understand? He said, I want you to declare the in the acharith, not the kids, not the acharuth. He said, I want you to declare the in from the beginning. And from the ancient time, the things that are not yet done. The prophecy, the Nabal, the prophecy that was spoken by those of ancient, and yet it is not, and it has not been done. It has not been carried forth to its fullest extent. You have not seen the revelation of that. You have not seen the light of that. You have no understanding of that. Now, I ask us a question. Here we have journeyed through this path, our forefathers, down this darkened road. You tell me that Yah, that is our Abba, that loves his elect, he shall not raise up the light of the wisdom of Yahshua HaMashiach in the midst to take us on down this journey, this path, that we may walk in his ways. That's why the men or those that are ancient, it is their life, their beauty, that inspire the young men to give them that assurance because they remember their former days. But not today. You find old fools, male and female. You find old silly men that no love of Yah you see. You can't tell. Come on. When a man loves his wife, there's a little twinkle in his eye every now and then. But a woman loves her husband. We love each other. We like to see each other. We give each other a bump. You see that with lions. They always rub against each other. I may be walking down the path, one of my ox, and I just, you know. That's just it. Let him know, come on, man. I may bump shoulders, you know, like, come on, man. Let him know I care for you. It's a form of touch. And just from that touch, he knows. Just bumping his shoulder. He understands. Where is that today? It's a cold nature today. You know why it's cold? Can I tell you, my precious Amen? Because iniquity shall abound. It did not say the love of a few, mi'ot. It used the word rabbah, many, much, abundantly. The love of many shall wax cold. There's no power of testimony in them. I shall, my friend. I shall. He says, I want you to declare that in Yeshaya, Isaiah 46, 10. And from the ancient time, the things that are not yet done. I have not performed those things. Verse 10. He says, my counsel and my itzah, my purpose, his itzah is his purpose, his desire. He said, my counsel shall stand. My itzah, my purpose,
shall stand.
And I will answer all my pleasure. So the counsel or the etzah of Hanukkah, it shall stand. But it must be declared in this time by those that are endowed by the Ruach of Yah, with the Ruach of wisdom, with the Ruach of the fear of Yah, with the Ruach of understanding, with the Ruach HaKodesh. They must have the power of the seven Ruachim of Yah. And a wise man, his countenance speaks more. He is heard more in his quietness than a champion that loves to congregate with fools. And there's no one that leaves with a breath of refreshing. Nobody is corrected. As I said the other day, we like to judge others more harsh than we judge ourselves. And come to my attention that some of the, not some, we only have one, throwing rocks at the chickens. And so we sometimes tend to the forbearing of those that are immature. We sometimes don't know how to make the precise judgment because we don't even know how to do that on our immature selves. We're immature, that's right. I don't care what you say, how you look. I use everything for us to learn. So there was a congregation of us. I said, how many of you all at that age can throw rocks at windows? Or chickens if you saw it? Or dogs? We did it all. Sure we did. We did all of that. Use that to show us the parallel that in our everyday lives, we are much more critical on those that we should be stronger than. We should bear the infirmities of who? The weak. So if one is weak, you bring them under your counsel because you're wise and you speak to them the principles of Yah and you show them by the beauty of, first of all, of your countenance that you speak from a plethora of experience. I used to love sitting down with her grandfather because he had this beautiful smile. He was a regal looking. His skin was so black. It was a charcoal glycerin blackness to it. And he would just delight in telling me the stories of the ancient. And he was smart. And it's one thing, they were always the same. And I could listen to them over and over and over. I never got tired of listening to what he said. I never did. I could listen to his story. So it was, he helped in that constitution of verification as to those things that are right. The remembrance of things that are valuable and important. So if we will judge ourselves, we got to do that because Hanukkah, he walked with Yah and he did not seek death. Sin had no power to draw him away from Yah. His mind, his heart, his passion, his desire was on the Torah of Yah. And if we have men like that, we will all keep the Mo'adim at the same time. We will all speak the same thing. We will all talk the same talk. We just don't have it because we have what we call the Naha boys that are trying to be men. And we got all men that don't have the strength because they have not nurtured their minds and they cannot draw back on the former things. I draw back on my former things, my life as a young lad, what I experienced. Having not this or that, I'm glad I didn't have it. I'm not ashamed of the way I live. I'm not ashamed of not having a mansion or a 10,000 square foot house. I'm not ashamed of that. I'm not ashamed of who I am. I got dignity. I can go out and stack beside those that are doctors and lawyers. You will not know who I am. They will not either. And I would not try to impress. I'm glad who I am. I'm glad. I don't want nothing, my Zaki. I don't want no big house. I don't want no fine car. Could have had all that. I don't want it. I don't want no $1,000 suit. Wouldn't buy. For that, I can make 25, 30, 40 suits. Hear this. In the 66th chapter of Isaiah, Isaiah 66, verse 3. What is the whole purpose of this? What is the catalyst of all of this that is going to be said from Enoch? It is summed up right here in Yeshaya, Isaiah 66, verse 23. But it all comes down to the finality of what shall be, and I will prove it out through the process of the book of Enoch. Isaiah chapter 66, verse 23. The Nobi says, and it shall come to pass that from Chodesh, from month to month, and from Shabbat to Shabbat, shall all flesh come and shall worship before me, says Yah. What is this implying? There's going to be a total eradication of the wicked. The mind of the wicked shall not be functionary. It shall not function in a process to understand the dynamics and the times of Yah, because sin dwells in our chamber, and because pride inundates our hearts and our minds, we cannot see the picture of the prophecies and the wisdom of those men of ancient. We can't see that. So it's all about one thing: we coming to the proper place at the proper time for the proper occasion and having one proper conclusion. That's what it's all about. In order to understand Enoch, you open up that book. If you have the book of Enoch, I want you to open up that little book, the chapter 1. In order for you to understand Enoch, you must understand the precedent of what is said. You must verify that with witnesses. In the mouth of two or three witnesses, we bring opposition and we bring a statement against the kingdom of darkness. So in the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. I want to read the first verse of chapter 1 of Enoch, the book of Enoch. What this book is all about, the summation of this first verse, it is carried out through the theme, the revelation of what is in the book. Enoch. Chapter 1 and verse 1. Hear the word of Yah, Yisrael. It says, the blessing of the Berakiah, the riches of Torah knowledge of Enoch, which he was blessed, which he, Enoch 1 and 1. The blessings of Enoch. Now, all of these great riches, what did he do? Which he blessed. Who? The elect, the Bohir, those that Yah has chosen, and the Sadiq, hear it. Who would be present? Who would be omad? Who would remain? Who would endure? Who would be a part of that process to bless the righteous? Who would be present? When? On the Yom, the day of tribulation, at the time of the removal, at the time of the removal of all the wicked ones. That's the theme of the book. That is the whole theme. That is the whole revelation of this book. Listen to this, because I must have a witness of that. In the next verse he says, and Enoch, the blessed and the righteous man of Almighty Yahweh, he took up this wisdom. He took up his parable. While his eyes were open, and he saw, and he said, verse 2, this is a Chadosh, set apart vision from the Shema'am, which the Melakim have shown me, the Melachiah, the one that is the messenger of Yah. That's what a Melach is, isn't he? Which the Melach has shown me. And he says, and I heard from them. Does it say everything in that writing? Yes. He said, I heard everything. I heard everything. I heard everything. He did not say I heard it in a partial statement, but I heard everything, everything. And I understood Ishmael. I heard everything, and I understood everything. When we hear things that we understand, when we truly hear, we understand everything. He said, I saw everything, and I heard everything, and this is the catalyst here. He says, I look not for this generation to understand or the revelation of that to be revealed, but to the distant one. It did not say ones, but to the distant one. Doesn't it say that? Yes. But to the distant one that is come in. There's a generation. And we are that distant one that Hanukkah bless. That he saw the wisdom. That those that want to go to the 53rd verse of Hanukkah, verse 3, and try to explain the veracity of this vision. And that's why we as a people, we are ignorant, we are stupefied, and we're dumbfied. We're trying to understand this wisdom by one or two little verses. And I hear men talk like that all the time. I say, I know he's ignorant. I know she doesn't understand. This is the catalyst of this book. This is the whole purpose of this book. The wicked must be destroyed. Why? Because there are things that are transpiring in the keeping of Yahs Moadim, and these are wicked. These are men that have the Rishia. They have a wicked nature. They have a nature that practice things that are defiant of the Torah of Yah. They are already judged, and they're going to hell, Yisrael. He says, I speak about the elect ones and concerning them. So he's speaking to you, Yisrael. He says, everything I tell you in this writing, you elect ones, I speak concerning you. I speak for your revelation. I speak for your knowledge. I speak for your wisdom to be inspired. That's what it says. Now, Hanukkah spoke with delicacy of wisdom, did he not? And there was one that came after Hanukkah. His name is Shlomo, Solomon. There's a purpose for what is about to transpire, Yisraya, and everything that is to take place. There must be a witness of that. He said, I speak to those of this time and the time to come, and for them to understand. What is this all about? Can I show us? You know, with your funds, you have a little change. You need to get you what they call the pseudepigrapha, the volumes, two of them. I think you can get them for about $25, $30. And it has all the written books of what we call the lost books in that. Here's a profound word out of the mouth of Shlomo. Just hear this. It says in the book of wisdom, this is a time that Hanukkah speaks about. He said, a time of the removal of all of the wicked ones. And Shlomo speaks after the time of Hanukkah in the book of wisdom. Two verses I want to read. Hear this. Write it down. Wisdom, chapter 7, verse 18. And verse 19, hear the word of Yah, Yisrael, Yah, wisdom. The book of wisdom, chapter 7, verse 18 and 19. It says this, listen now. The beginning, ending, in the midst of the times. He talks about the beginning and the ending in the midst of the time, in the middle, in the centrality of the time of Yah. You all listen to me, Yah. In the centrality of the time of Yah. Listen to me. Don't worry about reading. I'm reading from some other place. Just hear me. He says, the alteration. There's going to be an alteration, isn't it? That's what it says, the alteration. What is an alteration? It is a change. He said the alteration. Now, this is what Hanukkah talks to us about. He says the alterations of the turning of the solstice, of the sun, and the change of the seasons. The cycle of years and the position of the stars. That's what Shlomo said. He said, there's a time, you would hear the old saying, by our forefathers, I would hear my grandmother and my mother, we kind of took upon that same proverb. You know something is about to happen because times are not like it used to be. The winters are not like they used to be. The summer times, the days are not like they used to be. Whoever said that, that have some age upon them. We've all said that. And they would say, you know, we're in the last days of the time. It was the wisdom of our forefathers that they that was impregnated in their minds. That even the old mother or the mother of the mother's mothers had said that. And it was ingrained in that DNA in the mind of Yisrael. The wisdom of Shlomo says there's going to become a time or the altercation or the alteration of the times, the season. They will change. There will not be the sun, the moon, the stars, everything. Because the wicked has done such radical wicked things. They're trying to change the order of Yah, but Yah's going to remove all the wicked. This is what the book of Enoch is about, the alteration of the seasons and the times that we're in. You find men that read two or three verses and they can explain. But they have this mumble, jumble, lethargic expression. And they cannot take you to Torah. I search my path. I search. I find words I don't understand. I look at the dictionary. I want to find out what is that. Most people don't do that. We don't go to that extinct, and that's just the honest truth. I have purchased dictionaries of etymology and all kinds of books. No, I don't want to be a historian. This book is not a book of history. It is the book of truth. It is the book of truth, Yisrael. The truth of the nature of the people of Yah, our attitudes, and what persists in us. It is not a history book. It is only one story told. That's the story of Yah. In the beginning, Yah, he created the heavens and the earth. Now look what it says in Enoch now. I want to give us a synopsis beginning here, chapter 1. And then I want you to turn to Enoch chapter 69. It's important to understand this one verse. Enoch, turn to Enoch. Chapter 69, Enoch 69, Enoch 69, and then verse, I want to read verse 20, just one verse. Listen, Yisrael, I've read the book, I've read through it, I've read over, I've read under it, beneath it. In order to understand what this alludes to here in Enoch 69, 20, you must begin back in chapter 45 to understand just this one verse. And the reason you must understand the deeds, the actions of those angels that fell from heaven, that had the guardian power of the beauty of Yah's creation. And that's the truth. Because we don't love to lahad, we don't love to study. That's why we challenge men that have submitted their time unto Yah to understand the intricates and the integrity of Torah. So in verse 69, in order for you to understand that, you must go back to chapter 45. How do you know, Reach? Because I read and I study. And I draw from the conclusions of that. You must always go back to the beginning. Although you began at the end, you must go back to the beginning. What is the beginning of all things? Yah created it all. And if he did that, we can understand his pleasure, his desire, his passion, his will, his purpose to be administered in his creation. It says this in the book of Enoch, chapter 69, verse 20. It says this. This is the Torah of Yah's creation, the Torah of his power to create. Enoch 69, verse 20. It says, by the same ooth, by the same sign, by the same marking, it says the Shemesh, the sun, and the Yareach, the moon, listen to this, complete their courses of travel. So that lets me know, in order to travel, you got to go from one spot to the other spot. It is not the olam of the earth that travels, it is the sun. And the moon travels around the beauty of Yah because he made man to have dominion and power over all things. Cannot they send a spaceship out in the heavens, my bath? Have not they landed on the moon? I believe they have. when they complete their travel. So in order for you to complete a travel, you got to begin in one place and end up at that place that you're destined to. When they complete their travel, it says, they complete their travel and they do not deviate. They do not make one alteration. They do not change anything. They do not deviate from the Torah. The Torah made for them. There's a law made for the moon. There's a Torah made for the sun. I know I deviate from the Torah made for me. We all deviate. We've all sinned and come short of Yah's expectation. But the sun and the moon never deviates. The stars never deviate from the Torah. You got to understand that in order to understand the wickedness of man, how they have introduced all kinds of calculations. I have dealt with men that will read a few scriptures and they will present that to me. I say, but that's not the sum of what that says. He has hidden this stuff. And you don't find no treasure by just go opening a door. You may go into the door where the treasures are, but that doesn't mean you find the treasure. Just like the widow, she sweeps and she searches and she looks and she moves everything. And then she finds that treasure. When a man finds the treasure of Yah's truth, that's a happy man. That's a beautiful, bright man. His brightness shines with such excellence that he caused even the derelict and the wicked to smile and say, that's something about that man. Hear me, Yisrael. They do not deviate from the Torah made for them. How do I know that? How not did he walk with Yah? From the Bereshit, from the beginning of creation. And this is what sums it all up right here. The last word, forever. Le'olam vi'ad. Never can be. It is for eternity through antiquity. It has no end. So they cannot deviate from the Torah of their positioning, their place. Yah has confound the wisdom of man. He has confound the wise men to think they know. And he has revealed this truth unto babes. And one that does not present an opposition to him. That's, come on, Yisrael. Yeah. It's one thing that a man that is a babe, he always recognizes his fallacy, his failures, his fall, his sin, he always. And then Yah entrusts that man. He got to entrust someone. He trusts us with Yahshua HaMashiach. And that's the truth. So that is the beginning of Hanukkah, that everything has its course, its place, its proper position, because there's a Torah to everything, Yisrael. And we know that this Torah of that creation, it is Yahshua HaMashiach. Because we know that Yahkahan declares unto us, and the power of this massive thing that we are about to embark upon, and the word was the word was with Yahweh, in the Bereshit, and the Reshit in the beginning, and the word was what made, and the word was made flesh. It caused the Torah to become alive in Yisrael, and the Torah of the luminaries, there's a law that it never deviates. We have deviated. You're sure that he deviate from the Torah? We get this true mind of Yahshua. We will not deviate from the Torah. We will walk right in the sight of Yah. And we will do things right, Yisrael. We will love Yah. We will love his people. We have a great pleasure in his people, all right? So from chapter 45 to chapter 69, it deals with the misdeeds of the Melchim, their names, their actions, the activities of their corruption, and what they showered down upon man to open up his understanding. The book of Hanukkah shows us the Melach or the Melchim or the angels that taught certain things, all kinds of things, the makeup and all kinds of things they were taught. These are learned attitudes that we have and positions and dispositions. We have learned that. In chapter 72 of the book of Hanukkah, which is called book 3, from chapter 72 to chapter 82, from chapter 72 to 82, 10 books or letters or writing. It deals with one specific. It deals with the lunation, the lunar, the lunar activities, luminaries. It deals with the lights, the ores, from 72 to 82. That's all it deals with. How do you know, man? Because I searched the book. That's all that it deals with, those aspects of the heavenly things of Almighty Yah. It deals with that. If we look at chapter 72, verse 1, Hanok 72, verse 1, we've made these little rudimentary copies for you to keep and to read. You that will be blessed by this message today, everyone send an offering so we can purchase the equipment to make nice books to send out to you. And those that cannot afford it, we send them out free. Hallelujah. Look what it says in the 72nd chapter, verse 1 of the book of Hanok. It says, the book of the Sefer of the itinerary of the luminaries of the heavens of the Hashemayim. It talks about the position of each and every one. Doesn't it say that? They all have their position. We are not all members in particular in the body of Yahshua HaMashiach. And we ought not all have a particular service unto him. He said, each one. He said, in respect to their rank. So you tell me that they are creations that are greater than others? You tell me that there are ranks among men and women? Sure it is. Among their ranks, in respect to the authority? You tell me that there's not those that have authority? You tell me that Sarah, although she is a woman, the Torah, although she's a child called Rabbein, but she is still an Israel. She is still the same thing you call her mother. She is still an Ohotz. So you tell me that she has the authority to execute over a mother? No, she doesn't. So there's respect to authorities and respect to their season. They honor their proper place in the time of the Moed of Yah, so that we as a nation, the wise men, would know. We have men that should have the wisdom of Yah. They can tell us the precise times of the seasons to keep the Moedim of Yah. He said, each according to their names. They all have names. And that's what was revealed unto even Hanuk, the names of even the sun and the moon, the different names. He said, and their places of origin, and according to their months. He talks about Uriah, or Uriah, which Uriah. He calls him a Kadosh Melech. He was with Hanuk. What are the Melechim of Yah? Are they not the messengers of Yah? Do not the Melech of Yah encamp about the house of those that not talk Yah, but fear Yare, Gira, the fear Yah? So this Melech talked with him. And who also is their God. He said, all of the luminaries are guided by Uriah. He is their God. That's what it says. Does it say that, my Imabasia? It says that. They have a God. Just like Micaiah, he is the one that fights for the house of Yisrael. You understand? Just like the cherub or the keru, Hashatan was the beauty of Yah's worship of Shechah. He said this Melech, he understood and he knew. He had the wisdom of every circumstance and situation of their movement. He said, he showed me, he revealed unto me. Just as he showed me all of their, he talks about their treatises or their systematic manner. If you look at that word, would you try to understand what it means? Most of us would not. Let's just get real. And you want to debate someone and you want to oppose someone that wants you to understand and to know the wisdom of what is written in this book. That will labor to understand. He talks about simply the systematic manner, the course that they must go. We have a systematic manner or mannerism according to the Torah. We all walk alike, talk alike, say the same thing, eat the same thing. Even the world has a systematic manner. You go to the hood, there are places you don't go. You've never been in, don't just walk up in here, man. Everything in life has a systematic manner. You don't see a Willoughby's Gordon laying down with a lion. As Granny would say, he's going to get Ed up. They're going to Ed him up. And they're not going to eat him, they're going to eat him. All right, mama. He says, and they have this course by nature of years of the world until eternity. Listen, this is it right here. Until what? The new or the renewed creation which abide forever is created. So you tell me there's going to be renewed creation? That's going to be renewed Yerushalayim. He said they have that until the renewed creation. When we see that. You see, people will try to argue one scripture out of that without understanding the legitimacy of what is revealed. And they make themselves look silly. That's why I read what I did from Shlomo. See, a wise man, he holds back his word. He doesn't just speak all the time. He's wise, so he holds his words back. He doesn't want to crush anyone. He doesn't say anything out of his mouth. Well, I say what's in my mouth. Well, you're a fool. That's what the Torah says. A fool speaks what's in his heart. But a wise man, he ponders, he listens, and he hears what his heart speaks his mind. But a fool will tell you anything. Well, I'm an opinionated person. You're just a fool. You're sinning, you're open-minded. Let me move quickly here. I don't want to get carried away. I want to finish this. I got quite a few too much to read. So do we understand this? He says, till the renewed creation, which abides forever, is created. So that lets me know there's a renewing of life. The course and the pattern of the sun and the moon is going to be renewed. All of that. The weight of sin has caused such disturbance. This wicked mindset that goes and tries to change, alter the clouds for the rain and not the rain. Believe me, they're doing that. I was reading this morning there in China, up in the mountainous region of Sichuan. You heard of Sichuan Chinese food. That there was a massive earthquake. And hundreds are covered today. And they're dead. Because of the wickedness of man, they're trying to alter. They're doing their frackling, they're trying to drill, and they're greedy bastards. They cannot ever have enough. We need to come out of this system, this thinking, this mindset. You need to come out. Yeah. Learn how to care for Israel. Hallelujah. A selfish bastard will care for no one. Because a selfish bastard doesn't care for himself. So from chapter 72 to 82, it deals with the emphasis on the heavenly luminaries. You all read that. It doesn't take long to read that little book, okay? I want to give us some kind of a platform because I can't teach it all today. If I teach from that book, it will take me the rest of my life to teach from that, drawing the parallels from the old covenant and the renewed covenant to show you. Because I will have to teach each verse at a time. It's not something I just read. You don't get understanding by just reading. That must be an explanation. You must explain things. I'd rather explain two verses than to read. We went to that place that day and they read 300 scriptures. They didn't explain anything. I just sat there and watched. When they asked questions, the people fumbling to try to answer. I didn't show my wisdom. I could have answered the question, but I didn't do it. How do you say that in Hebrew? Well, I knew it. I just said quiet. And there are those that are silly and simpleton. Well, they go say that. That's how to say it. Because they want light to shine. I didn't want the light on me. I didn't say a thing. I was quiet. Didn't say one thing. Showed out unto the leader. Took him a gift, too. Never been to see me. Isn't that amazing? Can I proceed, my Achazipia? All right. I want to, in verse or chapter 73, it's important to understand this. This gives us somewhat of an analogous of the complete chronicle writings of Enoch. And in chapter 73, he deals with the variations of the moon, the light that illuminates its beauty, its Torah. And he says this in Enoch 73, verse 1. He says, after I saw this set regulation, there's a regulation set for the sun. He said, I saw another set regulation concerning the minor luminary whose name is Yariach, a Yerach, the moon. The sun is the greater light, and the moon is the lesser light. He said, I saw that. And with his knowledge of understanding the course, the regulations of both, he began to write or to expose things more emphatically here in the 74th chapter of Enoch. Enoch 74! And verse 1, he began to detail the relationship between the days, the months, the year, the coordination of the moving, going in and out of their positions whereby the Torah commands them. He begins in verse 1 of Enoch 74:1. I'm going to conclude one thing out of this whole teaching, and I will show you. What I began at the beginning, I will conclude it at the end, and you will see. All right? He says in verse 1, and I'm going to read verse 1 only, and I'm going to drop down to verse 11 for expedience to get at least a foundational wisdom in us. He says, furthermore, I saw another system of rotation. I saw another order with its own regulation whereby the system fulfills its lunary course. A moment, he says, I saw a system of the celestial bodies or the luminary bodies of Yah. And in coordination with the sun and the moon, I saw them complete. In order for something to complete a thing, one must begin a process. So all the things that Yah created was to begin a process to enhance the Torah of the Olam, the earth. And so the earth sits there, and it just revolves. And everything else evolves around this. I don't give a damn what that fool in England, Mr. Hawkins, says. I don't give a damn what the fool says. He's the fool. I don't care what they say out of NASA. I believe the book. And the fact of the matter, they will prove yours. Tell them to prove theirs. They cannot prove theirs no more than I can prove this. Yah is the proof of this. And that's why he revealed it unto the little ones, the babes, and not unto the wise. He confound those fools. They're looking for answer. And Enoch said, it was all given unto me by Uriah, the Melech that governs that. Hallelujah. Now, verse 11, it gives us this order. I want to move. If I try to take time to explain every scenario, it's going to impede the progress. So what he does, he shows us this lunar orbit or this lunar movement to create what we know as time. Time is unmeasurable in the sense that he has allowed us seconds, moments, hours, days. But in the Torah, in the Hebrew, it's all the same, the word. So he gives us this synopsis, this order here in verse 11. He says, in 3 years, now listen, in 3 years, 10 days every year add up to 30 days. So people say that's the 13th month. That's just a damn lie. Because the sun and the moon have a Torah of order. He says, and the moon falls behind the sun and the stars 30 days. Do you understand that? Do you really, you scholars of scientific evolution, do you understand that? No, you don't. You don't understand that. You talk with volume, but you don't understand that. He said they bring about all the years. See, that's what I know. He did not say they bring about some of the years, does he? He said they bring about cold, doesn't he? He said they bring about, but they fall behind. Now, listen. He said they bring about all the years, Is there punctuality there? Is it punctual? So if something is punctual, that means what? It's on time? Is it before time or after time? It's always on time. It brings it about with absolutely punctuality. There's a reason why things
that Yah has ordered this Torah, but not in the renewed kingdom. That's why we need the renewed mind of Yahshua HaMashiach, then we will understand Yisrael. He said that, oh, they come about punctuality so that they forever neither low cannot, they neither gain upon nor fall behind their fixed position for a single day. It is the same. I don't give a damn what man is saying now. Well, you know, you got to add this, you got to add it, and you're a damn lie. I hear men talk like that too, and they think they know, but they don't know. They don't lose one day. I don't care if they add a leap year in there. The time of Yah's celestial bodies and their order, they don't lose a day. They can add 10 days. We as a nation, we know what the moon, that's the sign unto Yisrael. We know. He said, but they convert the year with punctualness. You tell me that the year comes with such punctual integrity. Justice into 364 days. Well, we got more days than that, and a year doesn't mean a damn thing. And let me read on. Let me show you, Yisrael. We got men that are wise, but they're wise in their own conceit. And men want to be wise to challenge other men. I want to be wise to teach us. Yeah. There's much agony when a man becomes wise in matters. Because he's going to always be challenged. Most men think that they're wise so they can challenge each other and to reprove and to show what limited knowledge they have. You can't hardly read, man. How can you understand the dynamics of Yah? That some of us can't remember what we did yesterday. That some of us have difficulty remembering the names of each other. Well, that's Shekinah. That's Yashashana. That's Basia. We have difficulty remembering that. You tell me you're going to remember the things of the Torah? We can't be forgiven for Yisrael. We have difficult remembering. Are you going to instruct me in the wisdom of Yah? Stop it, man. Stop it, woman. They come with punctualist justice. 364 days. In 3 years, there are 1,092 days. And in the fifth year, 1,820 days. So we lose days. We don't know how to calculate that. No, Yah gave us the lunaries, the body, the moon, and the sun. I don't care if they say it's January the 15th. It means nothing to me. They keep their punctuality. They're punctuous. They don't lose a day or a time, but this is what happens, Yisrael. And we keep the Moed in its proper time according to what is shown unto us from the heavens. So that in 8 years there are 2,912 days. So there are men that try to calculate by some kind of numerics, and it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. In math, there are many ways to get the number one. The divisiveness of all to come up with that. And they think because they're mathematicians, they know. Isn't that how man disproved what they call, quote, God, unquote, through mathematics? Isn't Mr. Hawkins in Europe a crippled individual, can't even talk, in a wheelchair? Isn't he the most sought-after intellectual mathematician in the world? I read just a little piece the other day what he said, quote, Mr. Hawkins says that the Big Bang Theory doesn't need a God, unquote. I said, you're right, buddy. First time I heard you say something that is of some kind of reason. You ever said anything that has any substance? And he looks like a fool. No, I don't mock him because he's crippled. And this is what man regards. And through all their mathematical calculation, they cannot determine any type of specific of science to help him in his physical state. This is a thing of the wisdom. This is a thing that comes from the knowledge of Yah. And it comes by hearing wise men that you grow in. That you become wise. I'm your equal. You're not that man's equal. And you got to prove to yourself you're his equal. Moving quickly. I want to get done now. He says in verse 14, the moon singularly in 3 years, it days add up. Just the moon now. He's talking about a law, a total of the moon. It says the days add up to 1,602 days, so that it falls behind by 3 days in the third year. Now see, it's the moon because it has a Torah. You don't have to try to figure it out. You don't have to try to add up or subtract. You just obey Yah. And so there are men that want to prove that their calculation is right. I get stuff from people. I don't even read it. You understand? I don't read that trash. They're so discombobulated and so silly. They're trying to say, I said, this man doesn't even know what he's saying. Can I show an example? There's a group that call themselves, quote, they call themselves the white elect, the supreme. I don't give a damn if you don't like it. They call, but this man, he sends me his material every 2 weeks. I don't even read that damn trash. He takes material from here. He called Glenn Beck the prophet. He called Rush Limbaugh. These are the prophets. He called Jim Baker one of the Milach of Yah. He sends me his material all the time. I said, I was showing Oxymia. I said, look what he did this time. He took this right here from us. Of our sight. It's not ours. And he got this on his book. And I said to Maisha, look at this. Look at this. He doesn't write anything about Reach David. He writes about Jim Baker. He writes about Oral Roberts. Those men were luminaries of his God. And I have no problem with him. He's just wasting his stamps. I've gotten two of his books this week. His little monthly. I've gotten two of them. It's nothing said in them. He knows. He doesn't talk like me. He doesn't speak like me. So he gives us the coordinates of the moon, the sun, the days, how it does it. You don't have to go, well, we got to add a 13th year every so many years. Y'all, there's no one the Torah tells us that. And men do that. They're defiant, wicked beasts. Verse 15. In 5 years, they add up to 1,870 days so that it falls behind 50 days in 5 years that it is for the moon. Now, what is a day? Can I say this to you all? You've heard the scientific equivalence of revelation of a day. Okay, in order for them to get to the moon, they must travel 186,000 miles an hour that will get them 186,000 miles in a year. That's how they calculate that, all right? I remember that from school. So that's the speed of light. It travels 186,000 miles a second. If you shine a light in the heavens, it's gone. You don't see it. And the light never stops until it hits. It's amazing, isn't it? That light never stops. If it travels a trillion miles, as soon as it hits some innate object, it stops right there. You may think you shine light, that's the end of it. No, until it hits something, it doesn't stop. So when you shine it up in the heaven, I go out there sometimes, I'm going to set up a light. Yeah. Boop. Boop. I go out there and play like a little boy. Boop. Boop. See, I hit something and boop. And I know it doesn't hit anything. So can you, 186,000 miles a second, how do you even fathom that? We're at 86,000 miles a second. Now calculate all that up and see how far you get. See how long it takes you to get to the moon. I mean the sun. See, Yah tells us what a day is. A day with Yah is like 1,000 years. And 1,000 years with Yah is like a day. See, man has, he has defunct that. His wisdom. Well, add all this up. You go to computers and you divide it by that, and you get that, and you get this here. Well, brother, you get that over Hebrew history. All right, you're a damn fool, man. He's spoken in a way for the conceited not to understand. Move. I got to move. Verse 17, I want to move quickly. It says, in this way, you see what all I've just read? In Hanukkah 74:17, this is the conclusion. In this way, by doing this, the law of the moon, the law of the sun, the Torah of the celestial, in this way, the years are complete with what? Precision. So these are liars that tell me that you add a 13th year, you add that. Even through all of that, my Iman, It says the years are complete with precision. It is precise on time. The moon falling behind. Don't worry about that. You don't understand. Let me ask you a question. Do you understand the great dynamics of God? You understand this air we're breathing? I don't understand it. Listen, my precious one. I won't even try to understand it. I won't even search out the chronicles of the scientific chronicles or journals. I know it's Yah because he's the Ruach. That's all I need to know. I'm not worried about the elements of that. I'm not impressed with what the elements of air, elements of water, H2O. I'm not concerned with that. I know that it's a life source. I can go 50 days. I know I can go 50 days without food, probably 60. But I couldn't go in certain conditions 3 days without water. One of the most precious things, you better learn to love it. If you don't love it, I love water. You better learn to love it. My Uncle Yosef, he drinks it like he's drinking hot chocolate. No doubt about that. But they all complete their course with punctuality. They are punctual. Well, brother, let me show you here in the Torah. It says that. So if you don't add that up, see what it comes up to? It comes up to 360 days. You can't have it. See, you ignorant jackass. Talk to a little boy that somebody, they're out there will be impressed with that. Oh, yeah, yeah, see now. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You know why they're impressed? Because they don't know. They don't understand. It's easy to deceive a fool. And when someone's talking over their head and they're giving them certain kind of situations and different types of problematics, people like that because it makes them think that they are smart. Yeah. I was saying to my Ark Simeon the other day, we were talking to the Ark. I said, look, Ark, I don't want to be smart. I don't try to prove to you I'm smarter than you. What does that mean? I will prove one thing to you and any man. I will work harder than you. You're not going to work harder than me. I tell you what, in the final analogy, I will be exhausted. If you're not exhausted, you have not worked as hard as I've worked. I don't care what you say. If you're not expense, you're not finished, at the end of the day, I will work as hard as any man. I may not be as wise. I may not understand Torah like many men. I have no problem with that. But I will work as hard as any man when it comes time, when it comes to the toilsome labor, the farm work and all that, because Yah made that for me. I will challenge any of you all on that. Don't come here think I'm going to sit down and we talk and you like to talk. I don't do that. You want to get out in the cornfield with me and shuck some corn and cut down some corn stalks? I find out how much talk you got in you. At the end of that day, you're looking to go lay down. I like me. If I didn't like me, I couldn't like you. Yeah. I like me. How about that? He gives us this. They complete the year in precision, in accordance. Look with this now. Do you understand the coordination or the accordance of the fixed positions in the universe? Who understands that? Even science doesn't understand that. But these juvenile boys, they go out and look at the moon or get a lunar calendar. Oh, I don't want to start a star. You don't know a damn thing. There's a reason why we don't know. As I read to us, even as Yisra'el, when they kept, even Hezekiah had not kept Pesach in a long time. When they found out what it was about, that Yah honored that tree, he did. I was talking to Ark Simeon and Yah Rabbi Yah, and I say, and Yah, even after all of that, he filled the house of Yisra'el and showed himself and make himself known unto his nation. My bad, he's going to make it known through us, through you, through me, that we live this truth. They all complete their course with punctuality, with precision, and according with their fixed position in the universe and the fixed stations of the sun. See, they have a fixed station according to the sun where it shines. The gates through which the sun rises and set for 30 days. Who knows the gates that the sun rise and shut for 30 days? Who knows the Shahar? Neither does the most scientifically prudent minds understand that. But Yah does. The things that he has hidden for us. The things that Yahshua said, he said, there are many things I would like to tell you, but you're not ready. You can't even bear them. And there are things, my Beth, Yah, if he was to allow everything to be poured out upon us, the mind of man can handle it. We can't handle it. So he takes us by little, faith by faith. We grow by emunah. I'm so glad he does that. I couldn't bear it. You understand? I don't want to know everything overnight. I want to know what it needs for me to know to get through one course of life, and that's death. When the final hour comes, you don't get nothing by reading. I read that last night because you don't know what it means. That's why you read it. That's why you're talking about it. You want to impress me? You know what you're saying? But you don't know what you're saying. You want to show someone you read last night. Can I proceed? I will, man. Hallelujah. In chapter 75, it talks about the 364 fixed stations of the cosmos, not just the days of the year. Now, this is what this deals with. I want to read one verse here in Enoch 75, verse 1. It says, the leaders, so that tells me there's more than one leader. There's more than one Melachim that leads the order, that guards and govern the preciseness of the cosmos, of the created luminary bodies of Yah. He says, the leaders of the chiefs of the thousands, so how many stars are there? Are the thousands which are appointed over the whole creation, which are appointed over the whole creation, and upon the stars, so there are stars that are appointed over the whole creation, are counted together. They're counted together with what? The four leaders of the season. What that word four? See, now I would have to stop here and teach 3 years on that. The word four. What does it imply? The numerology of the word four, the four corners of the earth, the four winds of Yah. See, you just can't denounce that. So I must speak in general terms just to give us a synopsis or understanding of what he's trying to prove to us. It will go back to the Bereshit, it will go back to the Book of Wisdom, and because at the end it will close with the very same thing I read, all right? Moving on. It says, are counted together with four leaders of the season. They do not leave from their fixed stations according to the reckoning of the year. Well, everyone have four seasons. That's not the truth on the earth. You go to places, the temperature is constant. You go, my bath of desire. You go to the Antarctic, it's cold. It may be 60 degrees below zero today, but it's still 30 below. How do you tell 60 from 30? How do you tell 20 from 30? You can't tell it. You got places whereby the temperature is constantly the same. Even here in America. You go to places like San Francisco, it's the same. Folks wearing coats in San Francisco in July because of that Pacific cold water. You don't find folks going out there swimming all year. The temperature in Hawaii is constantly the same. The country where the temperature is constantly the same. You go down to Jamaica, the islands, they don't get freezing down there. It's constantly. Oh, it may drop down. If it dropped down to 75, what's the difference between 75 and 95? It's still hot. That's more than the four seasons. It's talking about the more dim, the seasons and the times. It's talking about the place of the moon where it's governed according to the rule of that Torah, and it must be in position. He said, and they're in the service on the 4 days which are not counted or reckoned in the year. There are 4 days, he says, that are not counted and reckoned. Why? Why did Yah hide this from us? When shall it be revealed? So has he given us the order of preciseness? They function with punctuality, yeah? The things he has hidden from us. Why? That we labor to understand and that we pray that Yah raise up the Nobi. And when the true messenger of Yah, when those true men are raised, we will know their messengers because we remember the former times and now we remember these times and we acknowledge them as being that. You can talk all you want to, it doesn't make you a messenger of Yah, it doesn't make you a prophet. I've had a group here one time, they were prophets and all of that in hell, and they followed after some of the most filthiest mess. I said, damn you all, you're nothing but little boys. You're not a Nobi of Yah. You don't speak by the inspiration of Yahshua, by the Ruach of Yah. These days which are counted. Listen to this. I know this because I read, I understand, I study, and I read. I'm not going to read all these chapters. I want to get to one point today. In chapter 76, you take your time and read this book, all right? You will see that even there's a capture there in the book. That's chapter 76. It deals with chapter 76, beginning in Hanukkah. It deals with the 12 winds and their gates. There should be a capture there beginning at chapter 76. The quality may not be the best, but it deals with the 12 winds. Who knows what those 12 winds are? It represents the blowing of the scattering of the 12 tribes of Yisrael, my bad. And the gates represent the shahad, the places where the gates that have been opened, where they come, when it comes to the spiritual, the mental, the physicality, and all of that. These are things, if you look with Yah, he deals with our spirituality, doesn't he? Deals with our physicality, doesn't he? Deals with our health, he deals with our mind, doesn't he do that? So that's what that represents. In order for you to understand that, even the cosmos understand that, you got to understand that, my Beth. And you don't get that, please hear me, by reading two or three verses there. It takes a labor, it takes a toilsome labor. It takes one waking up in the mid-hours and reading to understand, Beth. And then chapter 77, it deals with the four directions. Well, what are the four directions? Did not Enoch said he speaks not for this generation, but for the generation that is to bowl, to come, to enter in. So it deals with the four directions, the four winds, or the four corners of the earth, or the four foundations, whereby he shall scatter his nation. And it talks about also, it deals with the seven mountains and the seven rivers. Where are the seven mountains? Or what are the powerful Rahim of Yah? It is the wisdom, is the Ruach of revelation, the Ruach of fear of Yah, the Ruach of HaKodash, is the Ruach of wisdom, the Ruach of understanding. And the rivers, what are the rivers? What are the seven rivers? It is from those Ruachim flows the living substance of life, flows the knowledge of his Torah, the understanding. These men don't understand that. They're superficial men. They read without understanding. Wisdom is the principal thing, Yisra'iyah. But in all you're getting, you need to get understanding. You need to understand what this book says. So that's what it deals with. You're not going to read this and understand that. You got to understand what Yeremiah said about the 12 winds. I mean, the 12 rivers. You got to understand. You got to search it out. There are words that I found in this book. I searched them out, daughter. I won't lie to you. I can't find them. Only one I found. And it's a town in Nigeria. What are the names of the moon? I couldn't find it anywhere. I could find no history. I could find no equating of that name, any definitive of nothing. You don't need nothing fancy to find all that. You just take a perseverance and a will, because I want you to know. So when I die, you can teach your baby, and teach your son, bring him up in the fear of Yah, to love Yah. You work all your life, you die, there's nothing. You leave him a house, you see all this land, these old people worked all their lives to leave their sons and their daughters. They own nothing now. You leave them the heritage of your beauty, the knowledge of your Shu HaMashiach, your faithfulness unto your Ishua's strength, that you multiply his strength. You bring assurance to his bosom. I don't care. In marriage, you're going to have some trials, some bumps. But through all of that, you don't denounce your beauty and your place. Hear this. So it speaks about the four winds in Enoch 78. It talks about the waxing and the waning. I got pictures to show you all this. I miscalculated this teaching. I should have been teaching this last week where I could have showed you all this diagram, but we're right on Pesach. And I want to teach this really a month before Pesach. So I confer with my Zakin Yerami. I say, Zakin, I tell you, I would like to teach these teachings, but I need Wednesday night and Shabbat. I said, will you defer that time to me? He said, sure, yeah, sure. I said, you take Fridays. You defer that time to me. He said, sure. Well, I miscalculated my time. I didn't realize that, my Zachin. So I'm trying to rush to do it, but you will get some wisdom out of it. You listen to it again, you will. In chapter 78, it talks about the names of the sun, the moon. It talks about the waxing and the waning of the moon. I got pictures of the waxing and waning to show you what it all implies. Let me read one verse in 78. Let me begin here, 78 verse 1. It says in Hanuk 78:1, he says, these are the names, that is plural, isn't it? Hashem, the names of the Shemesh. When I was a young child, they would call the sun Joshua. My grandmother would call it Joshua. But this is what Enoch says. He said, these are the names of the sun. He said, one is called Rises. Who knows what that means? I don't. I can find no history of that name. Only Yah knows what it means. Our search, there was only one place. It is a book by Delma that gives some name of this, but it doesn't give us characteristics or understanding of it. I don't know what it means. It means simply, I know it means the light or the flowing of the sun. It says, and the second one is called Ta'um. What is Ta'um? What is Thomas? It means what? Twins. Now that one I could identify. It literally means twins. So you tell me that the sun, he said that is one name of the sun, Ta'um, twins, duplicates. So you tell me there's a light like that? That's what he said. Hear this. In verse 2, it says the moon has four names. Not two, not one. The Shemesh has four names. He says that the first name is called Asidia. That one, that is the only one that I could find that the name is mentioned. And it is associated with a little town in Nigeria. I searched it. I Googled it trying to find that Asidia. But I found it in one thing. I found no history. I could find it not in literature, in the writings of any kind of literature of those false individuals they have projected. I was in Walmart the other day. I'm looking at the 100 people that have changed the world. So I was looking at Homer. That this is a false identity of an individual that has been created. There's no history of Homer. And on the page of that, I could look at every person I knew, every last one of them. I knew exactly, I knew that was Gandhi, Mahatma Gandhi. I knew that that was Thomas Edison. I knew all the faces because, you know, I just knew them. I knew every picture on that. I knew that was Eleanor Roosevelt. I knew all of them. Every picture I knew. And so I skimmed through while my email was shopping. And then I came to Homer, to the literary. And then I'm reading on Homer or Tulsa, because you read the Russian poet or the Russian literary art, superb mind. People, because they say they can talk about Tulsa, they're smart. They think that's smart. That's stupid. Most people don't even understand his writing. So it had all of these individuals that are the greatest minds of the world that created. I said, yeah, what a damn shame. I said, if these are the greatest minds and these change the world, we're in a hell's mess. These damn fools should have never been born. These damn fools should have never been born. If these are the 100 people that caused the world to be enlightened and to grow, that's a lie. Then when it came to religion, they had, quote, Jesus Christ, unquote. They had Buddha. They had all these religions. They had Pope John II, this one that died, and they beatified him before his time, just like the dirty little whore Teresa. They call her Mother Teresa. She was a sneaky, dirty little thing to me from day one. What I will look at, I knew she was a dirty little heifer. And now the truth is coming out about the dirty little heifer. She was a liar. She was a thief. She didn't give a damn about those poor people of Calcutta. Throughout the world, she had a tremendous trove of money. You'd be surprised how they live. They put on this persona in public and they live. They drink the Bordeaux, $10,000 bottles of wine. They eat at the chateau. Damn your Mother Teresa. Damn your Jesus, your Lord, and your filthy damn God. Hear me. It talks about the word associated, the first name of the moon. And the second one is called Abla. Found no reference of that. And the third is called Benesi. No reference of that. And the fourth is called Ira. Ira. No reference. Not in the state of that articulation of the moon. Well, I know we're in the common era, but not of any association with the identity through Greek mythology or any of that. I found nothing at all. You see what Yah has hidden from this wise generation? It says here in verse 3, these are the two great luminaries. These are the two orbs of the lights that reflects the beauty of Yah, the sun and the moon. He said their roundness of the kaha, their roundness, is like the roundness of the sky. So if you would understand the dimension of the beauty of the moon, you can see that. But if you look at the sky, if you look at the horizons, it is like the roundness of the sky. He said, and the magnitude of the greatness, the gadila, of the roundness is equivalent for both. That's what it says. So something is equivalent, the roundness, it is the same, isn't it? You can draw the parallel. Well, the moon, because Yah said I made this lesser, that doesn't mean he made it any smaller. But I tell you, I can see that moon out there at times, man, and it looks as big as the sun. That's what he said, Beth. You see, men will read, but they will not analyze each word. They try to analyze the whole of what they have read through a mind that is not trained to understand. It is not, that's why doctors and people in position deceive us all the time, because they know they can't talk on our level. And we want to try to impress them as though we can talk on their level. I'm not trying to talk on a physics level. I worked under one Dr. Graham. He was a PhD in physics from Boston University. And he was an arrogant thing, but he didn't know he met a tough, simple man. He didn't know that. He said to me, he took his finger one day and said, wherever I go, I'm taking you. I looked at this boy. I don't want to go with you. I looked at him. And I got up and said, Dr. Graham, your problems. You don't take care of yourself. Oh, Roberts, try to save the world. Men were afraid of him because of his articulation. He used superlatives. He knew no one knew what they meant. I don't even think he knew that. But there was a man that his name was Herb Watkins. He was blacker than Zachin Benjamin, brilliant, regal, and he was bright as they come, because he was the CEO. And my managers would talk to me. They said, Riyak, you ought to see how he breaks Dr. Gray. He breaks the highness of mindedness of all of them down. His art. I would talk to him. One day he came by my station. And we began to talk. He said, where are you from? I said, I was born here in South Carolina, in the state below. He said, no, were you born here? I said, yes, I was born here in the United States. I went to school here in Charlotte, North Carolina. And I knew then it was something, you know, he knew me from that moment. He knew me. And so there was a time that I had to do a presentation to him with all of his managers. He had an office. I walked in his office at his conference room. I couldn't believe it. I'm like, whoa, here's a house. He was the CEO of Charlotte. Very refined he was. And so when I went to do the presentation, I'm before this august body. And the most important thing, really, I wanted him to be there because I was ready. You understand? I was going to pour it out. And old Charles Redman, I know my Imabazi, I remember him. Charles Redman, he wrote me a prophecy. He says, man, I tell you what, I was beyond impressed with your mannerism and the way you delivered that speech to us. He said, I like that man. Charles Redman, this nerdy, snotty little devil, that's what he was, wasn't he? He was a nasty beast. Our light will shine. Our gift will make room for itself. I don't care whatever gift you've got, a gift of kindness and love. I'd rather have that than to be skilled as a scientist. I'd rather have that than to be an architect. I would. That I have the ability and the gift to have kind affection for Yisrael. I'd rather have that above all things. Can I move on? Because I'm going to finish my Zachin, all right? He talks about that roundness in verse 4. He said there are seven more portions. They're divisions of light. Who know those seven portions of light? In Enoch 78:4. See, we think we know, but we don't know. There are men that read this. Well, they're talking about the seven portions. He's talking about the seven Ruachim of Yah. Hear me, Yisrael. And when the Ruachim of Yah, the seven Ruachim of Yah shine from us, there's the brightness of his power and the revelation of Yahshua. We sit here. They listen and we are an ignorant people. Seven more portions of the light that moves the sun. It is the Torah. It is the Torah of the sun that moves it. It moves the sun's spear. It says the light that moves the sun's spear, that in the moons and it increases in measure unto the 70 portions of the sun and its completeness. Hallelujah. I mean, it went down to Yerushalayim, I mean, went down to Mishraim, to Yosef. How many of Yisrael went down? 70. How many went down? Say it again, man! 70! Not 71, but 70! And we think we are wise. Yeah, I want to drag us under the dust so we'll know how ignorant we are. I'm not saying this to try to belittle us, Yisrael. We got to be sharp. We got to be wise as a servant, but humble as a dove. Everything, I was talking about Simeon, I say everything has its metaphorism. Everything has a meaning. Everything has a purpose. We're all going to get together. We're going to teach on each commandment. I'll take the first one. Shembri, all of us, we're going to teach. Give all these old men to. We're going to teach on each commandment and show the mitzvah what it means, what it entails. Hallelujah. I got the first one, okay? I'll take all 10, but I'll take the first one. I want to hear what the Ark have to say. Has 70 portions. Number 70 came out of Mizraim. This was made known before the 70 went out of Mizraim. This was known. This was known. And they came out as a renewed kingdom, did they not? A kingdom of riches. How, can you number the stars of the sky? You cannot. Everything has its metaphorism. Everything has its meaning, Israel. It would take me 10 years to teach on this, and I still will not be finished. Can I move on? I pulled the Zakenya Ramay on you on that one. Hallelujah. Ah, yes. Where did I stop? Verse what? Okay, verse 4, yeah. Have the 70 portions of the sun complete. It says, look, that the moon, now it uses the word comes, doesn't it? It's not the earth that comes. It is the moon that yatsa, the moon that comes out. It exists. It is the moon that comes in and goes out. When something comes and goes, it means it is in, doesn't it? It comes and goes through the western opening of the circles of the circle. Yah sits on the circle of the world, Yisrael, yeah, via the northeast and rises up. It gets up to the eastern opening before the face of the earth. Now, you got these juvenile scientific minds will explain that to you. I can explain it to you, Yisrael, yeah, but it takes more than me just reading, all right? When the moon began its cycle, when the moon began. So if you began something, it means you move, right? When the moon begins its yirach, its cycle, its lunation, the monthly movement, it appears in the sky. One half of the seventh part. It has the seven ruachim of Yah shining upon him. It shines in one half. It shines in one half of the seven parts. It will become fully, listen now, it will become fully illuminated, or from the 14th day, the time of Pesach, Leviticus tells us about that, 23, yeah? It will come fully illuminated. Verse 7 of 78, Hanak, it completes its illumination, its light of instruction, the Or, the 15th day, becoming fulfilled according to the sign of the year. See, that's the sign of the year. It did not tell us because the moon fall back in days. This is the signs of the year. It becomes 15 parts. And thus, the moon waxes in 15 parts. Verse 8. In its decreasing in size, the waning, the moon decreased on the first day of the 14th day of its light, its aura. On the second day, it decreased in the 13 parts of light. On the third, so forth. It gives us that synopsis as how the moon increases and decreases. I'm not going to read all that because I want to finish up here, all right? Verse 9, you all read that. Verse 9 of 78. It tells us in certain fix. The word fix is kun. Incertain fix. When Yah has fixed something, when it is kun, it is firm, it is established. So there's a Torah to the moon, that's the Torah to our life. Incertain fix months. Hear this, there are months that are fixed. The moon completes its cycle, it tells us, in 29 days. So we're going to add that up by our calculation of our mind, we get 348 days. And we're going to add this up as far as a year. It said in certain fixed months, 29 days, in certain others, 28 days. To understand that Yisrael, we must read Leviticus 23. It explains it. It gives us a better detail. It has its fixed months, fixed stations, fixed times, according to the Torah of that. Then in the 10th verse, it says, Uriah, Uriel, Uriel, the Melan. Uriah is that Almighty Yahweh is my light. He is my light. Uriah, Uriel. He showed me another order concerning now, listen now, the light, the or, the ma'or. When light is beamed into the sun, from which direction of the bright sun is beam. He showed me something that man doesn't even understand. So he brings it down to our analogy through his superior mind of ours, that we can prepare ourselves for one thing for this time, Yisrael. He says in verse 11, during all the moed, the season, the appointed times of the season, he said, when the yare of the moon is made to run its cycle. If something is made to run, when you start up a car, it is running, right? So it begins the course that you direct the car to go. So it is with the moon according to his Torah. It says the light is beamed into the moon, facing the sun, until the illumination of the moon is complete in the course of 14 days. When it is complete, it radiates light in the sky. It caused light. It is the sun that caused the light to shine, that caused the moon to radiate the light. Although you don't see the sun, it caused it to radiate light. It caused the sun to shine and to illuminate the light. Hallelujah. Verse 13. Oh, I got to finish this. 13. Quickly. Now look at this. These illuminations are complete in exactitude. They're precise. They don't lose nothing. In exactitude on the day when the sun. Now, it tells me that the sun, yarad, it descends. I want to define that word. Yarad. According to the vines, the Webster, the archaic meaning, it means yarad. It says the sun descends. It doesn't say the earth descends, does it? It says the sun yarad, to go down, to descend, to decline, to march down, to sink down. You understand? It is the sun that goes down. How is it that we say the sun rises, and yet we don't say the earth rises? And yet we believe what science says. I believe what Hanak says. It is the moon. It is the sun that yarat. It says it descends into the west. Does it not descend into the west? It rises in the east and descends in the west. It doesn't say the earth rises in the east, but it descends into the west. And the moon simultaneously, you don't see it, rises in the east in the evening, shining during the night until the sun rise opposite of it. The sun is up in Australia somewhere, and the moon says, it's time to get up and go, baby. Got my Torah, got my law, got to follow it precisely. Shining during the night until the sun rises up, until it rises up against the sun. Hear this, Yisrael. Verse 14. From the same side where light enters the moon, from there is also a gradual waning. Hear this. Until all illuminations disappear, what we call the new moon, and the day of the moon expire, it disempties without light. Well, that's the new moon. That's when we began to understand where the Moedim began. Let me read on. I got it. You're not dealing with a novice here. It says that the moon, not the earth, the moon coordinates in respect to its days and season. For 3 months, divisions. In the course of the recession, it makes 3 months in each in 30 days and 3 months in 29 days. So we just got February, the month with 28 to 29 days, right? In the secular Gregorian calendar, we're talking about the great light of Yom. Is that during the seasons or the appointed time or the modem, it makes it recession in the first period, starting at the first gate, at in 170 days. In the course of its progression, it appears 3 months each 30 days and 3 months each in 29 days. By night, it appears like a man. In day, it appears like the sky. For there is no other thing in it. There's nothing in the moon. There's no oil, no gas. There's nothing in it but light. Probably they went to the moon. They went to a distant place. But y'all say there's nothing in it but light. There's nothing in it but light. There's nothing but the word of Yah. There's nothing but him. Yahshua is the word, isn't he? Is he the light of the world? There's nothing in it but light. There's nothing in it but light. There's nothing in it but light. I don't give a damn what they could call the moon rocks, for they're basically throwing them away now. They don't mean anything. They went to the moon, I believe it. Their moon. They didn't go to Yah's moon. There's nothing in it but light. There's nothing in it but light. Hallelujah. The moon now coordinates in respect of its days and season, verse 15. For 3 months division, you ask the average individual to try to break this down and explain it. They try to break it down through a convoluted, twisted mind. They cannot explain it, Yisrael. Trust me. They cannot explain it. They do their best to try to convince me, but they don't convince me. I said, you're wrong, man. That's not what that is saying. You miss out the whole thing. Let's go back to chapter 83. I mean, chapter 52. Now look at that verse, and let's move. You got to understand what he said from that. And that's how men talk. They've learned to talk that way. The moon coordinated in respect of his days and season, 4 3-month division in the course of the recession. It makes 3 months each in 30 days, and 3 months each in 29 days. During the season, it makes the recession in the first period. In verse 15, I've read that, haven't I? Yeah, let me move. I want to go to Enoch 79. I got to get this thing done. I want to get it done by 2, all right? We greet you all again in Yahshua's name. You that have fallen off, we appreciate you. Fall off. I'm not falling off anything. This is going to be somewhat of the conclusion, the summation. He kind of concludes the astronomical or the astrophysics of all creation, how it works. It's not meant, Yisraya, who understand how to build gigantuous structures? You don't understand that. Who understand the mathematical form when you see buildings like the Empire State Building or like the Sears Tower, I've seen it. How does that thing stand against the turret wind? The winds up there are greater than the winds below. How does it stand? There are states that don't even build buildings like that. There was a time the largest building between Atlanta hit. There's no tall buildings in Miami. But the farther you go north, the higher they are. There are no tall buildings in Los Angeles, California, like it is in New York and Philadelphia. Philadelphia really don't have no true tall buildings. But how do you understand the dynamics of that? That, you know, people reading from Hannah, telling me they understand the dynamics of the celestial, the cosmos, and the astronomical. You know, it's just so silly. They have not spent any type of length of time to understand that, but they understand. They don't understand. We have beguiled ourselves in our own conceit. We think we're wise. And it's sad. The 7th, 9th chapter of Hannah. This is where he makes the summation of all that was spoken unto him. 79 verse 1, he says, now my son, this is what Uriah said to him. He said, I've revealed to you everything, not some of the thing, everything. So the rule concerning all the stars in the heavens are conducted here. He said, all, didn't he? All the stars, all the conduct, it is here in the book of Enoch. He showed me all their respective rules for every day. So you tell me there's a rule for this star over this star, that star for every day of Yah's creation? Sure it is. You tell me that a man that walked with Yah did not see death, and it took the messenger of Yah to come down from Hashemah to teach him that. You think your little juvenile brain gonna understand that? Stop it, you immature little boy. For every season, for every authority, for every year, the procession of each one according to the mitzvah, the commandment, every month and every week. Every month and every week. Everything is covered. Hanukkah 79, verse 3. He said, the total discernment of the moon, which it makes through the sixth gate, and the light of the sixth gate is disposed of after these at the beginning of the discernment, which it makes in the first gates take place in its own season until the 170th day are fulfilled, following the rules of the week, 25 weeks and 2 days. The moon falls behind the sun according to the order of the star exactly 5 days, during one period, i.e. the half of the year. And when the place which you behold has been traversed, Such is that appear the picture of the luminaries, which Uriah, the chief Melech, who is their ruler, he showed me. And he showed me the stars and the sun and all of the altering, the altercation, what they produce, and what shall prevail in this time. He showed him all the summation of all things. He had the mind. It takes a pure mind to ascertain the things of Yah. That's why we must cleanse ourselves daily from all filthiness of the flesh and the ruach, and perfect the set apartness of Yah in fear by the ruach of fear. So after all of that, he's taught him from, all this came from the messengers of Yah, the whole writing of Enoch. This is the total culmination of it all in the 80th chapter of Enoch. This is what it's all about. Can I go back and read what I read in Enoch 1? He says in Enoch 1 and 2, I want to read the last part of verse 2. I look not for this generation, but that generation is to come. I speak about the elect ones concerning them. The book of Wisdom 7:18 said, the beginning, the ending, the midst of the time, the alteration of the turning of the solstice of the sun and the changing of the seeker, the cycle of the years and the position of the stars. This is what it's all about right here. That's why I began there. And I'm going to end with that same wisdom. It says in Enoch 80 verse 1. In those days, Yosiam, the Melech Uriah, responded and said to me. He says, behold, I have shown you everything, Enoch. He showed him everything. Isn't this a generation of men that know everything? They can tell you where the gates are. They can't even, they will talk like silly clowns trying to show that they are impressive instead of saying, I don't know. I don't know what that means. I don't understand this cycle, but they know it all. You'll be surprised. No, you will not. But those arrogant beasts that contact me and they know everything. I say, why you call me? You don't need my approval. You know it, don't you? Well, I want to teach you. I said, well, put up a website like ours. Get on. You put it up. I'm not putting it out for you. And I don't. He said, behold, I show you everything, Enoch. I have revealed everything to you so that you might see this sun, this moon, and those that guide the stars of Hashemayim, as well as all those who interchange their activities and the season and rotations in their procession. So he says to Enoch, the luminaries, the ma'or of the celebration of the creation, it's almost like this. You have this great activity of parades. You got people doing all kinds of compilations of things, everybody doing something. And it all meshes into this beautiful spectacle sight. He's saying that you got all these stars just working together in between the moon and the sun and all of the celestial bodies. Everything got this place and it's moving. It's such a gyration and everything is precise on its time. And when it's finished, everything lines up according to the Torah of that. Yeah. That's what he's saying. This star is blinking in that one because it's signaling that one because, you know, and that one, the colors of the light are all different. And the greater the God, all the Gavel, when the sun sits there and says, he shines the light, boom, and the moon says, it's time to rise up, baby. Get up. It understands its command. It would take me a long time to explain it and to do it with emphasis of emotion. Yeah, I got emotional when it comes to this. Hallelujah, Yisrael. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Verse 2. It says, in respect to their days, does he say the sinner? In respect to what happens, the sinner, the wicked man, the sinner and the winter are cut short. Yahweh sent his milak to reap. And when he reaped at the close of Sukkah to put all it in the garden, the barn for his people. He's going to send the messengers to reap up the tares. He says that the sinners and their winners cut short. Their seed shall lag behind. They shall not have any fruit, any peri. The sheaves shall lag behind in their land. And their fertile fields and all of their activities upon the earth. He will turn, the sinner will. He will turn and appear in their time. Yahweh. He will withhold rain. And the sky shall stand still for his time. So you tell me what Yahushua, what we lost today? It's a damn lie. It's a damn lie. I don't care. The moon, sun stood still, but everything worked in the coordination and the coordinates of what Yah commands it. There's a Torah. This man became before Yahushua. He gives us insight. Then the vegetable shall slack and not grow in its season. I see that here now. And the fruit shall not be born in its proper season. Why, Yah? He says the moon shall alter its order. The moon shall to confound the wicked. We better be wise, Yisrael. We better hear. The moon will alter its order and will not be seen according. Did not Yeshua say from one Shabbat to one more of them, we shall all come to worship? How are we going to be precise on that? If the moon shall alter its course, if the sky shall be darkened, he's talking to the elect at the last time. We're going to need some wise men, daughter. We're going to need men of wisdom. We're going to need ancient men. We're going to need the Zakein that are wise. They are studious. Their actions, their activities are profound. Their look is one of light. Their look is one of trust. You look at some of our faces, we look so damn hard and nutty and crazy looking. I wouldn't trust that damn face. Looking like a damn moron, we look. Don't try me out there, all right? I would train my countenance to reflect the beauty of Yahushua. Yeah. And folks that smile all the time. That's all right. I'd rather see them smiling all the time than to not have the look that is beautiful. Yeah. Listen to this. In those days, it will appear. It said the moon in verse 4. The moon shall alter its order and will not be seen according to the normal cycle. Well, he gave us the normal cycle, didn't he? Yeah, I just read that. 4 months at this time, 4 months at that time. That's what man need to understand, that they can after days. After, isn't that simple the way it was expressed? These damn fools, I call them. They want to complicate matters. It is not that difficult. It's not hard to understand. So we're going to have wise men, studious and Torah, say, no, no, hold up. No. This is the day. It's there. Well, I don't see it. Don't worry about it. I'm right. We've got to have enough regard and enough respect as the moon and the suns respect the order of their order and respect those that guide them. Even that has a guide. Even the sun has a guide. And we damn rebellious, stiff-necked beasts and hard-headed as hell. I don't trust nothing and nobody where the sun and the moon and the stars and the celestial bodies of Yah. They trust Oreya and those that guide them. We such a jackass generation of stupidity. It's pathetic. I don't give a damn if you don't love me. You don't even love you. There are not too many people going to hear this kind of teaching today, my son. Bank on that. It is the truth, my sure, my ox. I was talking to my mother there. I said, Shimri, you know the big man moves. He moves like a stealthy tiger. So I saw him other morning. I said, I'm going to catch him. He said, no, I'm not going to let you do that. He said, no, son, you forget that. You're not going to do it. Shimri said, he used to move. I said, he still moves. He moves like a big bear. He moves. So what did that do for me? Wow. That motivated me to try to catch him. And it motivated him to say, no. Look at it, see. He think I don't know. And so that motivated him to say, no, sir, preacher man. If I have to start jogging and put you on the spot, you're going to be in trouble. And so he caused me to save a little time, and I got in the house early. I said, thank you, big man. See,
we don't need nothing like that, because we always think we got something.
That's how silly we are. He was a great of a motivation to me as I was to him. It blessed him. It caused him to pump a little faster and a little harder. When he looked back, he said, oh, he's gone now. Okay. I can get my stride back. See that? He knows I know what I'm saying. Hear this quickly. In those days, verse 5, in those days it will appear in the sky. It shall arise in the evening in the extreme end of the greater lunar path. Lunar path. Who knows the greater lunar path? Oh, we understand the different phases of the moon, but who knows the greater lunar path? In the west. And it shall shine forth more brightly. You tell me the moon is going to happen. Man, it's already shining bright. We come out of the tabernacle one night. It was a full moon. And Jeremiah said, oh, Poppy, look at that. I got to take a picture of that. Oh, I got to go and get a picture of that. I said, Zakhain, come here, my friend. And take it to take a picture. So he jumps in the truck. All right. Out working all day. I said, no, you take some pictures. She come there. Poppy, you want to see my picture? I said, no, I see them. I saw the picture last night. See, that's how we need to get excited about it. Yeah, that child was just enamored. Oh. And Zipporah, oh, she got picture of moon. And it shall shine more brightly, exceedingly the normal degree of light. Hold that. I want to read something that Amos said. Amos 8 and 9. See if there's some kind of coordination between him and Hanak. Amos 8 and 9. He said, it shall come to pass in that day, said the sovereign Yah, that I will cause the sun to go down at noon, and I will darken the earth in a clear day. He said, I will cause the pattern to alter. We've got to have men that are wise and ark. Listen, you cannot get that intricate of wisdom until you begin to examine every aspect about you. You become a beautiful man. You old men need to become beautiful old men. That the young men look to you for great wisdom. Your words are sound. It amplifies strength in their bosom. Can't be a clown. You could have the beauty of the countenance of Yahshua. When Moshe came down from the mountain, they could not look upon his face. Why? Because it shone with the honor of Almighty Yah. Can't shine with the frownness and this distorted look on your face. You got to change that. Same thing with you, Bath of Zion. I don't take nothing back. Yoel says here in Joel 2:31, the sun shall be turned into darkness in the Hoshek, and the moon into blood before the great and the terrible day of Yahweh's, Yahshua's coming. That's what it shall be. That's what shall happen. It shall be Yisrael. Verse 6 of Hanak. And there are two things I want to close from. I want to close from Ecclesiastes and Revelation. Well, let's go back to verse 6 of Hanak 80. It says, many of the chiefs of the stars shall make error. See, that's what Yah says, those that got. They shall make error in respect to the order given to them. They shall change their courses and functions. Listen now. And do not appear during the Moedim, the season, the time, the appointed times, which have been bestrived by them. He put, in the beginning, it said he created the sun, the moon, the greater and the lesser light for the seasons. He created all that for we can mark the time. We got to have men that are wise, sound, to teach the young men what to look for, what to understand, to be led by the Ruach, that there be supplication. We must have that. It must be a bit pattern of their life, how they live. They must be an example unto. He said, this shall happen, Yisrael. Now, this is what all this is climaxing into. Verse 7, 87. He says, all, not some, all the orders of the stars shall harden its disposition. Against who? The sinner. If you are sin in the trespasses of your sin, you will not know. If you are wicked man and pretending, it says the wisdom of the lunar actions of Yah, it will harden its position against the sinner and the conscience of those that dwell upon the earth. The star shall err against them, the sinner, and modify all its courses. Yah said, you're not going to know a damn thing. You call yourself sons of Yah, and you're nothing but fat-out sinners. You're wicked. You're false. Yah says, you're not going to understand. You're not going to be able to discern. That's what this is about, Yisrael. That's why we got such difficulties determining which are the more damn of Yah. Because we're full of damn sin. Hallelujah. He said, the stars shall err, change his order against them, the sinner, and modify their course. Then the sinner shall make air and take them. See, and they shall begin to take to themselves gods, stars, and create gods. So what are their gods? You think, who's the stars of these little whole house gathering? The man that calls himself the preacher, isn't he? He's the star, isn't he? Fat, greedy belly pig. He doesn't give a damn about the people. He's the star. All the light, yes, I'm telling the truth, my bath. And they make him, oh, Reverend Roberts said that. I believe, I don't get what you say. I believe Reverend Roberts. Reverend Roberts said that. And they shall make themselves stars as gods. They illuminate those. That's what it's about, my Beth. Oh, it means that in the actual too, but it means that it has more than just one ramification. And see, there are men that are teaching that, well, they make gods out of stars. You silly man. What star you know is the god? They can't even tell you one star. They can't tell you one star. They don't know one star. But they talk and they're silly. You know what, my Beth? It's one thing, I've always had an analytical mind. It doesn't mean I have to question that. You understand? I don't have to question things to get knowledge of it. I watch things. I watch people sometime and I watch how they respond. And then to break all of that, to show them what they really have. I said, how you doing, man? How's everything? How you feel? Oh, I'm feeling so fine. I feel chippy. I said, I hear you, man. You walking. You got life in you. You better feel chippy. He said, I do that to people. I don't do it to women now. I do it to men. They'll walk. They won't even say, hey, man, how is everything? How you doing? Couldn't be doing any better. I say, I tell you what, I like to be doing the way you're doing then. Do it all the time. Man, give me a hand right here. Sure, boss, man, I give you a hand. Yeah, look at you. How old are you, man? Man, I'm 69. I tell you what. Don't put me to shame. 69 rolling like that. You'd be surprised. When you have a kindness, you'll see that in the people's face. When you are a moody piece of a, that's a dysfunctionality. Can I read that so we can close? It tells us order would change and modify their course. The last part of verse 7. Then the sinner shall err and take to themselves stars to be gods, the gods. And evil things. You hear that? This is what this is all about. These men trying to calculate and show us numerically about the order. He says, and evil things shall multiply upon them, evil things. And he talks about niga. He talks about the plagues, diseases, and sickness shall come upon them so as to destroy them all. It's all about looking for God. It's looking for God and finding some constitution of a God. And the profoundness of the utterance of Yahkahan in Revelation chapter 13, verse 14. Revelation chapter 13, verse 14. And this God deceived them all that dwell upon the earth. It talks about where they dwell upon the earth, that dwell upon the earth by the means of those Sibeon, not Mopheth. Sibeon, when he had power to do in the sight of the beast, sent to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image of the beast which he had been wounded by the sword and did live. You don't give credence. I know that has a practical amplification, Zacchaeus. But we know this Nahash must be wounded by the sword, by the Kereb. And there's only one sword, the word of God. That is a sword to it. So it must be, and you don't revive that beast. You don't say, well, he shared that to me. I'm better than that. He rebuked me. I don't do that. You don't do that. Yeah, I know what this means, Imabazia, but it has an implication that's far greater than what these men are teaching folks, because people, you know, they don't even understand that. It means that that when the sword of Yah is drawn, this beast, this Nahash, rises up against Yah. When this wicked mind, this Nahash, rises up, say, I am God, I am superior, I'm supreme. And Yah said the sword, the life of your shoulder, the revelation shall wound you. And that sword cuts and kills and destroys. And then they raise that up. And they cause that life of their wickedness to rise up against Yah. And then they begin to say, I got power. Can't nobody. I made it. I'm successful. The ramifications are much simpler than we know. And men, because of their arrogance, they want to exude themselves to say, I know more than you. I don't know more than you. I can't tell you nothing about having a child and understanding the ordeal I can't tell you that. But I can tell you the truth. So everybody wants to be precise, a professional. Everybody wants to have everything. I don't want everything. I don't want everything. I want all I need to get into the kingdom. And what he gives me today is sufficient. Sufficient unto today is enough. That's enough. If he gives me this is all I need today now. I don't need nothing. I don't need to add to it because it's going to mess me up. It's going to mess me up. Yes, right. This is all you need today. You don't need to chew on nothing. Just chew on this. Can I close with this last bit? I want to read this. And hallelujah. In Koheti. And chapter 12. I want to close in this. Ecclesiastes chapter 12. I can't get through all of this, Yisraya, but I want to give us a brief synopsis of what this entails. It's all about we knowing, understanding what shall be, and there are wise men among us to say, no, don't go out. Don't go out of the house. Stay in the house. One shall be taken, and one shall abide. One should be on the top of the house. One, don't go down into the house to see what's happening. But I want to close with this here in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 1. Yah commands us to remember our Creator in the days of our bechoruth, in the days of our youth, when we're young. We're young in our youth. He said, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw closer to death, when you shall say, I have no faith, I have no pleasure in my life, I have not enjoyed my life. And then he says in verse 2, while the sun, S-U-N, or the light of the moon, or the stars be not darkened. So let us take pleasure in Yah now, before this time of the season, this Moed come, that we can't discern Yisra'iyah. Let us take pleasure in the beauty of Yahshua HaMashiach before that day approach. You understand? We're in that day. We're in the Akaritha. He said, nor the clouds return after a rain. When there is no outpouring of the Ruach, when there's no outpouring of the Torah, when the famine is in the land, not the eating of food, but the hearing of the Torah. Let us, as a nation, he said, in that day, I want you to hear this as I close. In verse 3, he said, in that day, when the keeper of the bed, he shall tremble in great terror and great fear. They locked the whole city of Boston down last night. The whole city was locked down. I've listened, I've kept abreast of it. They said it was a dark-skinned man. And it was amazing when I listened to the police chief talk. I said, my Israel said, what in the world is that? He says this quote, well, it was a light-skinned Caucasian. She said, what is a light-skinned Caucasian? They had no compunction to say it was a dark-skinned man. And they could not even get that out of their mouth to correct them. Cause people havoc and hell. If you're wrong, say you're wrong. Admit that you're wrong. Don't be a damn coward. When I'm wrong, I'm wrong. When no one else wants to take the responsibility, I'll take it. It's here because of me. This is happening. Okay, it's my fault. I need to pray. Don't worry about it. We'll get it right. Don't blame it on no one else that you think are less than you or don't have the strength you have. That's easy. That's a weak man or a weak woman that does that. I take all responsibility. I take it all. I don't care whether, you know, most people, they don't want you to show them where they have failed or they have missed. They don't want to take it. Well, I've never been like that. It's my reason, all right? It said, and the strong men or the higher men, they're going to bow down themselves. They're going to be broken. They're going to fall. Help me, Yatana, fall. They're going to bow themselves. And it talks about the tochan or the grinder, those that labor. And the tochan, one that grind and labors so hard. You know what the word tochan means? To operate in the office of a concubine, a prostitute. They have prostituted themselves to this world system. They have prostituted their mind. They have prostituted their children. They have prostituted the essence of them to this system. And that's what it means. Those that at the grinder, those that grind. The grind of the prostitution. You selling yourself is going to cease because there shall be no jobs. There shall be no finance. They shall cease because, what? There are few. You got few people with jobs in this country today, don't you? There are people, the unemployment is 50%, 60%. We just look at this little wicked nation here, but there are people throughout the world, they can't find jobs. There are places in Russia, they're poor. There are places in the United States, they live in shanty towns that are just filthy. Because they are few. And those that look out of the window, I have a message on that one word, the window. And if you understood what it implies, what it means, it, as the old folks, it would blow your mind. And those that look out the window, you need to understand that. And those that look out of the window, it shall be dark and it shall be hoshak. You will not know the time of the season. Unless there are wise men there, unless there are men that understand Hanak, and they have labored for not 2 or 3 hours or a day or week, they have labored all their lives of the preciseness of that, my amen. There are men that have worked on mathematical problems all their life, and they have not concluded to the sum of what that equals. They have not, my Beth. You understand? They have not. And we think we can work on Torah for a few days, a few little readings, and we understand the logistics and the legitimacy of that. You are a silly, damn man. You are an ignorant woman, and you don't know a damn thing. You don't know nothing. You don't get the sum of this in 1 or 2 readings. You find one little word and you think you understand the totality of what is being said because you're trying to define that word according to your ignorance. That's not how it comes. It takes the total of the sum. You can't build a building like this with just one block, can you? It takes the total of the blocks and the frame and the mortar mix and all of that. You think you're going to understand the dynamics of the Torah because you understand one little word, you silly man. You mature woman, it doesn't work that way. So I'm glad for his hasid, his mercy. May Yah enrich you all. Come on, Zaka, and dismiss it. Yeshua's mighty name. May he bless you all. May he strengthen all Israel.
Hallelujah. We do bring Yahweh for his mercy, his ahava, for the teaching on today, Israel. Let us not just hear a message like this and we just lay it to the side. Let us listen to it again. Hallelujah. That we may get all the nuances and all that the message may rest in our love, Israel. It's important that we understand what Yahweh is doing and how, in the order of things, Israel, that we can teach it to our children that they may understand. Let us stand to our feet, Israel. Hallelujah. Yahweh has given us this Shabbat day, and not only has he given it to us, Israel, he's also fed us also. Hallelujah. But Yahweh, we do barak you for this beautiful day you have given us, for your mercy, for your truth, and your hava, Yah, that never fails. We do ask that you would keep Israel, Yah, those that are scattered abroad throughout the Olam, that you provide that which is needed for everyone this day, Abba Yahweh. We do ask that your Melechim will be encamped around Israel, and those that have come here at Teshua, those that are listening by via of live stream, Abba Yahweh, that you would take them home safely, Abba Yahweh, and keep them, Abba Yahweh. In all things we do, Barak you, we give you Todah, in the precious name of Yahshua HaMashiach, the Lamb of Israel, that which has been offered to you, Abba Yahweh, in full for the remissions of the sin of Israel. In all things we do, Barak, we give you Todah, in that precious name, Yahshua HaMashiach, we do declare, hallelujah! 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 Yabarak Kol Yisrael! Hallelujah!